Happy to be teaching history at Otago, he continued to pursue his passion for studying the Sikhs in his own time. But with Sikhs nowhere to be seen in Dunedin, he had only his books for inspiration. One day, hearing that there might be a Sikh community in the North Island, he headed for the Bay of Plenty to see if he could find them.
So we got in the car, me and the three boys, and we went looking for Sikhs. And when we eventually found one, it was like, you know, you think you're picking up a single thread, but in fact the whole net comes up because they all know each other.
That simple act of curiosity began something much bigger. With a grant from the university, Hugh went around the country visiting the families of every first-generation Punjabi immigrant. Anxious not to intimidate his interview subjects or prevent them from speaking openly, he devised a simple set of 12 questions, the answers to which he could commit to memory without any recording device, not even pen and paper.
And then when I got out of there, and got round the corner, I stopped the car and wrote down everything that had been said.
He discovered that the earliest known Punjabi immigrants arriving here in the 1890s were street merchants or hawkers selling goods door to door. Then, from the early 1900s, Punjabi men left their families in India and came to New Zealand as itinerant workers, mainly labourers, in central North Island towns like Whanganui and Tomaranui. By the 1950s and 60s, they and their descendants had enough money to buy their own farms in places like Waikato and Pukekohe. But for many decades before that, scrub cutting was a way of life.
What I hadn't known was that their scrub cutting was, in the years after the Second World War, were out of Whanganui out toward Taihape, which isn't that far from where we lived and out of Fielding. I hadn't the faintest idea that they were there. Fordell was the main centre, and every year they had an annual meeting in Fordell, so it was interesting.
One of those scrub cutters was Jussa Singh, who came in 1918. Later, he brought his 16-year-old son Swadan to help him. Swadan stayed on in New Zealand and, decades later, was one of those Hugh interviewed as part of his research.
We cannot even imagine how rough it was. And Dad told us numerous stories about their life. I think the first time he was given a cabin, it wasn't till the 50s. So they actually lived in tents. And he told us of stories of it being so windy in the King Country, they couldn't put the tent up.
Hugh collected first-hand accounts like this and compiled them in a book. Until recently, it was the only published record of Indian immigration to New Zealand.
It was a sort of side issue in a way, but it became, to a large extent, a main issue for me, living in New Zealand and finding Sikhs in New Zealand.
A side issue it may have been, but Hugh had touched on a desire to preserve and extend the recorded history of Punjabis in New Zealand. With the help of this Tomaranui Sikh, he published a second book covering a further 50 years.
So this book places on record the history of the Punjabis for 100 years from 1890 to 1990. It records their courage, their initiative, their hard work, and the photographs themselves tells a lot of history. The way they were, what work were they doing, what sort of dress they were wearing, where they used to live in the huts. Had it not been for him, the history of early migration of Punjabis would have been lost. Nobody else could have done it. He's done a wonderful job. He can speak Punjabi, he can write Punjabi, he can speak better than most Punjabis in New Zealand. So we are very, very privileged that we have Hugh McLeod.
His value wasn't limited to local matters. 1984, New Delhi, India. Prime Minister Indira Gandhi was assassinated by her Sikh bodyguards in retaliation for her government's military operation, Blue Star. That operation, aimed at squashing Sikh militancy felt to be on the rise in the Punjab, led to uproar.
Professor McLeod, perhaps we could start by explaining why there is this conflict involving the Sikhs.
For an insight into the background to these catastrophic events, the media turned to one of the few Western academics qualified to comment.
Independence of India and the division of India, which left the Sikhs a divided people, with so many had to come across to the Indian side of the border at that time.
The attack had centred on the Golden Temple, killing hundreds, burning the temple library to the ground, and destroying dozens of sacred texts presumed to be lost forever. Among them was one of the oldest Rehit Namas, a manuscript of Sikh doctrine, but it hadn't disappeared entirely. 12 years earlier, Hugh had returned to Amritsar to study that manuscript for himself.
And I must have been down to a bazaar somewhere and got a account book, and I found that the number of lines on a page corresponded to the lines of pages of the Ratnama, and set about copying the whole Ratnama by hand. It wasn't the idea that many people have for a fun time, but nevertheless, it was good.
Back in New Zealand, he translated his handwritten copy into English and had it published before donating a copy back to the Golden Temple. This book is just one of many academic and popular texts published over 4 decades. But they're only one part of his legacy. He taught history to generations of students at universities in Otago, Toronto, and around the world. He pioneered not only an emphasis on studying original texts, but also the value of oral history as a serious tool of the historian's trade.
He's been very significant because he was one of the first historians to actually use oral history and use it to investigate and explore the history of an ethnic group. And his research was particularly on reconstructing the history of the Punjabi settlers in New Zealand. That research has then been used by other researchers, and it's also been used by the community, so that you can go to the Sikh database website and you can find out about people can find out about their ancestors, which is quite amazing.